everybody, welcome to Analog Stick Radio, episode 30. I am your host, Mitch, and as always, I am joined by these two suckers that I trick into hanging out with me every Tuesday night by pretending we have a podcast. Mm-hmm. Over to my left, we've got the bearded man himself hanging out with his lovely banana pal. Chris, how are we doing today?
I'm doing great, thank you. That's the best, most accurate intro you've ever made.
Yeah, we're actually not even recording this. We don't broadcast it anywhere. I just trick you guys.
I just have
friends for one night for like an hour. My God. It's great. Friend number two down below me, as always. Dakota, how are we doing tonight?
We're doing great. How are you doing?
How are things on the West End? You holding everything down over there? You just keeping everything in order?
Everything is great. Everything is great.
Awesome. Guys, I need you guys to tell me what you guys played this week, because all I did was play Tabletop Simulator. Like, it's actually a problem. I need to seek help, because it's really, really bad. I just keep playing. It's insane. So, Chris, tell me what you played this week. Let me live vicariously through your gaming experiences.
I'm not going to go into what I played, because something interesting happened in the game world. It's kind of a big deal. Nintendo released their first mobile app.
They did. Miitomo?
Yeah.
Is that what it's called?
Miitomo.
Did you do some Miitomoing?
I downloaded it. And I got to say, it's not anything important. You wouldn't miss out if you don't join it. But
excellent.
Stuff that is coming out of it is hilarious.
Yeah.
So what is it? Tell everybody what it is, because I have no idea what it is.
Basically, you have your Mii. Actually, for those at home, I'm going to show you a little picture of my Mii now.
Oh, look at him. He looks kind of like Mario, doesn't he?
Yeah.
So it just looks like Chris, but he's got a Mario hat on and he's walking around.
Yeah. So basically, you set up a...
Everyone, it's a dolly.
Sorry about that, guys.
You make your character and you set up your voice modulator. So everybody has like a weird robot-y voice. And you can speed it up or slow it down. So I have some people who I've talked to and it's like, hey, how are you? But like a weird robot. And then other people are like really slow and weird, like, hey, I'm a great dude robot voice.
So can you talk to other people, or are they pre-recorded
you can't,
lines?
But the thing is, the whole point of this is that it's kind of like a social media experiment where like you have your Mii character and then you add people to your friend. You add people to your friends list, and you could do this via, if they're in the same area as you, I guess over Wi-Fi, or you could do it through Facebook or Twitter. And the Facebook and Twitter implementation is very well done. It's just like you'd hope it would be in 2016. Like, sure. You click Facebook, and then it's like you log in real quick, and you don't have to do anything else. It just logs you in and then scans your friend list and see if anybody else on your friends list has Miitomo and adds them, or like lets you send them a Miitomo friend request. Okay. So the whole point of this is like you get on every day, you see what other people are up to, you get on and yourself, your little avatar, will ask you a question like, what were you doing a few minutes ago? Yeah. Or what's your favorite food? And then so you answer and type in your answer, and your guy will read it out, like he'll read it in whatever robot voice you picked. And then, so like other people, when they click on you, or if you go on your friends list and see their activity, you see what all your friends have been doing, and they'll read it to you in their little robot voice. But the funny thing is that you get to make your character and put them in these really weird poses. The only thing I can think back to is like almost WarioWare style, where like these poses and like little sound effects are so bizarre and Japanesey. And it's like, I have a picture of like me like holding my hands up to my chin and just going like, ah!
What about, do you have this one? Do you have this one? The peace signs over the eyes?
Peace signs over the eyes. Yeah, that's a classic.
But there's like people who are doing great meme pictures, because you could upload any background you want. Sure. So somebody uploaded like a background of a guy at like a hot dog eating contest, like, you know, just chowing down. And then he put a picture of his Miitomo like dressed up in a hot dog costume, laying down, looking sensual on the pile of hot dogs.
Oh my God, that's beautiful.
Like, there's so much hilarious stuff out there.
You said it wasn't much to talk about, but if you can be sensual with hot dogs, Chris, I think I'm on board.
I mean,
you've already got Dakota. He's sitting there going, okay, how many things can I do with this? I think he's already downloaded it, and he's actually like making some as we speak.
Like, it's not revolutionary. It's not a game at all. But it is very fun for that aspect. I don't know how big this is going to be or how long, but if you look around online, you're going to find some really good pictures out there.
Well, we may have to go download this, guys. It's called Metomo. To go ahead and make sure you check it out. Dakota, what did you do besides look at hot dog pictures?
Hot dog pictures were probably number one on my time sync this week. Number two was taking care of my new house. Number three, though, I didn't actually play any new games. I played a game that felt like a new game, and that was Street Fighter V. It saw a couple of updates. And for those that don't know, if you guys don't remember, when it first came out, it was kind of feature light, almost incomplete, many would say. And they patched in a bunch of features that were supposed to be there at launch. They released their first new character. They expanded friend lobbies to be as large as 8. So you can play like 8 friends instead of just two people. So it feels really good. If you were holding out because you were afraid of how anemic it was, now it's the game it's supposed to be, and it's awesome.
Huh. Great. Well, like, did they add story, like beef up the story mode? Because I remember it was kind of...
They didn't beef up the story mode. Unfortunately, that is still a sore spot for sure. However, they did add challenges. So there's a bunch of content that you can do per character that kind of teaches you how to play, teaches you some bread and butter combos with each character. If you literally know nothing, you could jump in there and it's going to tell you the kinds of things that you should be doing. So it's already more than it was in what it should be for sure.
Is there more content to come? Like, have they announced like maybe more things, or does it just feel like maybe they're going to be adding more content as they go along?
They're always going to be adding. Oh, they also have new costumes on deck that got released, got revealed. They're always going to be adding new stuff, new characters. There's 5 characters that are going to come out this year. We got one of them on the 30th. New costumes like crazy, and they're approaching the game as a modern game. They're all just DLC, you know, kind of Dota or League of Legends or Heroes style, where you can either use hard currency, your cash, or you can use a soft currency that you earn in game and spend it and get your stuff.
That's good.
So it's almost like if you don't want to farm the in-game currency, you could pay real money for early access to these costumes.
You could say that.
One could say that. Speaking of early access, let's move on to our main topic.
Oh my god.
So if you haven't already guessed, by my very, very casually
ham-fisted. Ham-fisted.
Internet high five.
If you haven't already guessed by my very casual transition, today's topic is about early access. We're going to be talking about a lot of different games, the philosophy behind it, where we've come because of it. But I think the best way to start it off is let's talk about the fuck is early access. So if you don't know what early access is, I have a little bit of a definition from our good old boys at Wikipedia here. Early access, also known as alpha funding or paid alpha, is a funding model in the video game industry by which consumers can pay for a game in the early stages of development and obtain access to playable but unfinished versions of the game while the developer is able to use those funds to continue working on the game. So you basically, they're giving you almost like the first half, almost like maybe like the first 70% or whatever. And then
hopefully,
you know, you get at, right. Exactly. That's the hope. And then they continue using all the influx of cash to complete the game.
Yeah.
So you're almost like betting on the game at a certain point, like betting that it will be good and will actually be a release and all this other stuff.
I think it's important real quick that we differentiate this from Kickstarter or Steam Greenlight. So for instance, in Kickstarter, it would be somebody has an idea out there. So you put in money to fund them beginning the idea. Right. You get bonuses. This is they're already in the process. Like, they've already done the groundwork and they want you to get in on it halfway through, pretty much.
Right. Like the earliest thing I can remember is, like, Chris, you and I got into the early access for Minecraft.
Yeah.
And I paid for my copy, which I think now they're like $30. I paid like $11 or something for it.
Yeah.
Like, it was back when it was like nothing.
Before there was a client, you have to play it in the web app.
Yep, yeah, you had to play it in the web app. And then I remember when the client came out, that was magic. I was like, this is the best thing ever. So yeah, we paid like $11 for access to the game, and then that carried through, and I can still play it now. So
speaking of Minecraft, was that your guys' first early access game you ever encountered?
For me, that was my first early access and my only early access game I've ever purchased.
Chris. Look at old man Chris already.
Old man Chris.
12 minutes in and he's already here. Nice to see you, old man. That was actually my first, but not my only. I have encountered others. I'm sure we'll name drop them as we go along, but that was my first. Dakota, what about did you get into the early access of Minecraft, Dakota?
I did. Yeah, it was definitely my first. That game, I was playing it, as you said, long before there was a client, back when it was nothing, you know, there were no fucking horses, there was no mod support, I mean, there was nothing, and we played the crap out of it, built pyramids, and lit each other on fire.
Yep, it was great. So, let's talk about how we feel about it, and so this is why I call Chris Old Man Chris, because it's almost like blatantly obvious that he's not a fan. So we'll save you for later, Chris. Dakota, how do we feel about early access, just as a person and as a gamer?
Well, I guess you'd have to look at my Steam library to really see how much I adore early access, or at least exercise my monies on early access. I've got a lot of early access games, a lot.
Do you have any that you want to mention?
All sorts, man. I've got Ark. I've got Darkest Dungeon, which is now released. I bought Invisible Ink before that was released. I've mentioned that game on many, many, many episodes. Too many. I could open up my Steam window and like just run down the list. I do have a lot that I don't play. Like I'll play for, you know, a couple hours and go, okay, well, have fun with my money. The Culling, of course. We've been playing a lot of The Culling. That's an early access.
That game.
Many. So I'm a fan for sure. But I do recognize that, you know, there's some give and take with early access we'll get into in a bit. What about you, Mitch?
I'm in the camp that I like it, but I don't know enough about it, and I don't pay attention to game news to find out about them. Usually I find out about them around the time that they're released.
Oh yeah.
Like I only know about these games if you tell me about them. Chris told me about Minecraft. You told me about The Culling. Like I only, a buddy of mine at work told me about Ark. Like, I only know about these games because other people tell me about them. I didn't find out about, like, a game like Kerbal Space Program until well after its release, so.
Oh, okay.
Now, when you say release, do you mean release into early access or actual their game release?
Their game release.
Okay.
Like, I found out about Kerbal Space Program, like, 3 months ago.
Wow. Where have you been?
I don't know, man.
What the hell?
No kidding, man.
I just didn't find out about it. DayZ, I found out about, I think, like a year ago. Like that early. Like, I didn't.
Wow.
I had no idea what the game was. Well, Mitch, I found out about DayZ when Rust was in early access. That's when I found out about DayZ.
Okay. Because Mitch has mentioned before that he's, like, not a huge gaming news cycle kind of guy. He's not always digging for the newest bits of...
I'm spoiled because I'm best friends with Chris, and Chris is a news.
We talked about it. I said that Reddit curates my news, and you said that Chris curates your news.
Chris curates my news. So why do I have to look it up? Chris will just tell me when something cool happens. Chris, like, literally, he called me.
That could be your Chris WWE called me and name, said, hey, Chris, the curator.
The curator.
Yeah.
Come on. Let me show you
ready a world for the of curator. Pain. Exactly.
Yeah, Chris called me on the phone and he said, you need to snap into the Minecraft. You know, he told me about this Minecraft game. And I just was like, all right, I'm going to just, you know what I like. I'll just trust you on it. So I don't really, but any game, like I gave Ark my money. I gave Minecraft my money. I gave The Culling my money. So, I mean, like, I'm a fan if it entices me. But as we've seen on this show, it takes a lot to entice me. You got to have a really specific set of credentials. So.
All right, so Mr. Chris, I only have one early access game.
Yeah, hit us with it, old man.
Is there a reason?
I don't like the idea of early... I like the idea of early access, but I don't like it in practice. Because a lot of times, like I've mentioned before, especially with the episodic gaming, I like my game finished, right? Mm-hmm. There's a certain kind of... I don't mind beta testing a game,
right? Because that game's pretty much everything that they want to do with it, they have it already planned out. They okay. know what their game is going to be. They're just kind of ironing out bugs at that point.
And also it's free.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, but like...
I mean, that's worth mentioning.
But the thing is, companies have to normally pay for quality assurance. Now they're having people pay to be their quality assurance.
Right, but is that wrong, though? Because they're getting quality assurance by the people that matter. Like, I don't give a shit what Joe California is saying. I want to know what real live gamers are saying about this game.
Yeah, that's a great point. But when you do that, a lot of times, like, the expectations here are so high for both sides. Like, the people who opened this game to early access, there was a big debacle, right? Where early access is in this place where people are... It's gotten very popular over the last couple of years. Kickstarter started with everybody being able to fund stuff. Then Minecraft and DayZ got big with getting people into actually playing a game before it was quote-unquote released. And so everybody was like, oh, you know what? I want to get in on the ground floor. This is really exciting. This game that I'd kind of heard about a little bit, I'm going to be able to play it before it would normally be released in like 2 years. Mm-hmm. This is so extra cool. And then so they go in expecting this great experience, and then there's like, it's missing some major core features that when they start understanding how game development works, and especially a lot of these early access are like one or two guys. So they open this up hoping that all this money coming in sometimes from these early access people is going to help them fund and get through faster when they just won't. So everybody has these high expectations that are all let down.
Okay.
I mean, the H1Z1 debacle, I'm going to bring that up really quickly.
Do it,
they
yeah.
brought, they kind of made a big deal about releasing this game into early access. There was a big thing in the news. They're like, yeah, they're kind of marketed it almost. Like, hey, look, H1Z1, we've been working on it. It's a game kind of like DayZ where you're surviving and there's a bunch of zombies and stuff. They're like, yeah, this is going to be great. And then they had a bunch of people talking about a bunch of marketing. The day of early access came out. They had a lot of streamers excited. So all these streamers are ready at 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock rolls around. Servers are shit. Nothing's working. Nobody's even able to log on the game.
Okay.
3 hours pass, everybody gets in, a couple streamers are there, and everything's breaking and crashing still because it's early access.
Right. That's right.
Like, right, you should expect that. But then these developers are making it seem like, oh right, everybody's gonna come in, it's a release date for early access. You can't have everybody expect to be like, yeah, we're just gonna go stroll along killing zombies, blowing everything. Nothing's ready yet. It's not gonna work for you.
Mm-hmm. Right. Like Blizzard has problems with like WoW's release
yeah.
date.
Diablo was like unplayable. Diablo 3 was like unplayable for 2 weeks.
Yeah. WoW, I mean, WoW has its problems every time a release comes out. I think they've kind of ironed it out now, but I remember back in the day, like TBC was a shit show.
Oh yeah.
So I mean it just happens. It is what it is. I mean, sure. For the big guys and for the small guys. And so that leads us into like, let's talk about the pros and cons of early access, right? Chris, you've mentioned already a lot of different cons. Let's start off on a positive note though. So what are some of the benefits of early access? Obviously, namely one is something I've already mentioned. You get real-time feedback from the actual people that would buy your game. Like yeah. that's a big deal. Like I said, like yeah, you can pay for quality assurance. Or you can like get real quality assurance essentially for negative money, like for free. Mm-hmm. Let people give you money to give you quality assurance. Like that's something you can't pass up as a business.
That's definitely big. Like everybody getting... Go ahead, Dakota.
Yeah, I was going to say, and that's kind of why it's so alluring to a developer, is it almost sounds like a win-win. You get money and you get the most valuable feedback you could ask for that you also right. don't have to pay money for. So you save money on both ends of that coin too.
Right. It's yeah, and obviously like the second pro is obviously money. Like getting more money to fund your project is definitely a big reason why they do it. Mm-hmm. Chris, can you think of any pros? Like I know that you hate it, but can you think of any like good reasons why
the early easy ones?
I mean,
we really should have. But I want to press on him though, Chris. Like what do you think?
I mean, no, the pro
like don't think about it.
That's definitely I want to go to the negative because you're talking about that particular point, I guess. But another pro would be, I don't know, boring. The fact that people can make what they want with this. If you get early access, it really shows that people are willing to take the risk on something that's very interesting. There's one game in early access right now that I'm kind of interested in getting because to me it seems almost finished, and I don't think this guy is going to be finished for another 8 years.
Okay.
So I might as well just play it now. It's called Spy Party.
Oh,
right?
Yeah. Right. He's been working on that for a while, hasn't he?
For since 2006 or something, right? This guy, it's him and one other guy working on this game, mm-hmm. the coder and the art guy. And basically, it's pretty much the game style is almost if you take TF2's sniper versus TF2's spy, right?
Yeah.
The whole game is it's a room, right? It's a room and it's
Mitch,
a
you
social
don't know this
party.
One? Mm-mm. Oh, this week's.
It's a room.
Chris didn't tell me about it, so of course I don't know about it.
I mean, it's not it wasn't done, so that's why I didn't tell you about it. It's,
fair enough.
It's a room, and it's a social gathering, and you're playing as a spy, as one of the people at the social party. And there's a lot of characters. There's a Sikh, with the head wrap, and he's in a tuxedo, and then there's a guy in a wheelchair, and there's an old woman, and there's a lot of different kinds of people. Because you just have to, you have missions where you have to, either get a bug and place it on, an ambassador's arm or something, or, put it in his jacket. And the whole thing is, all your actions as a spy are very subtle. And you have to try and blend in with the rest of the computer characters. Because the sniper has one shot, one bullet, and it's instant kill. So the sniper's job is to kill, find out of, the 20 people at this party who is the spy, who is the actual human.
Yeah, he has to distinguish the player amongst the NPCs.
Exactly. And the spy has to act like the NPCs, in the to get their, their mission done within the time limit.
I'm watching it now. This is the greatest thing I've ever seen. This
I was
going to
say,
so
for those not watching
ridiculous.
Video, Mitch's mouth was just agape in awe and joy.
I'm watching this game, and it's literally a guy pretending to be a computer, and then there's a sniper laser just scanning the room looking for him.
Yeah. Yep. This game looks phenomenal. That's nothing. No one will do that. Mm-hmm. Minecraft. No one would think oh, let's make shitty graphic blocks and see if people make houses out of it. No one's going to fund that. Microsoft doesn't have a room full of guys in suits what's the next thing they'll make us billions of dollars?
Well, they do now.
One-on-one? Yeah, maybe. Yeah, now they do, actually. Yeah. But they bought
He's
Mojang,
looking at a book. It's looking at a fake book.
Mitch is still watching this, not paying
this
attention.
This is insane. this is the dumbest game I've ever seen, and I want to play it.
Yeah. That speaks to the power of this early access, being able to fund these amazing concepts that you won't get anywhere else.
Mm. Oh my God.
That's a good point.
This is
so,
the greatest
so
thing I've ever
pro
seen.
Is,
so,
is...
Yeah, okay, I gotta close this because I'm going to watch it all day. I got to close this fucking thing. Yeah, that's a big benefit, is that you get more diversity amongst gaming. We don't just have to rely on AAA titles anymore. It's kind of one of the other reasons.
Uh-oh. We lose Mitch?
Code plan, so to speak.
Sorry about that. We had a hiccup. I think we're back. We're back. So say what you said again, Mitch.
Oh, I was basically just saying that it allows for less overhead, which allows for more publishers, which is exactly what we're talking about. You get to essentially pay an installment plan on developing your game,
sure,
which helps anybody because you don't have to be Joe Moneybags to develop a game. So let's talk about maybe the cons. Chris, I'll toss it to you first so you can knock the easy ones out of the park.
I want Dakota to toss in a pro there first.
Oh, okay. Dakota?
Well, I was going to say what Mitch said about beta testing. I just said that it's nice to – I was thinking it's just nice to have so many people beta testing your game, basically. Mitch narrowed down on the extra benefit that not only do you have a lot of people, but you have the people that are most interested in the game. So I think it works doubly in that way. The beta testing value is huge. And then, of course, the money, being able to have your game funded kind of in a live manner, because – a lot of small studios just don't have the capital. They don't have investment at all. And so they're not left with many options. And so now they are. Now they have options that didn't even exist in the industry, you know, so many years ago. It seems
and,
like...
And actually... Go ahead.
It seems like culturally, we everybody... You mentioned Kickstarter a moment ago. I think culturally, we're becoming more and more okay with kind of offering our money to things that we believe in, but we can't, like, that aren't tangible, that we don't have in our hands yet, which is kind of weird because I would say that we're kind of an instant gratification culture, but maybe yes. Not. Kickstarter is, uh-huh. And really all these endeavors are absolutely not instant gratification, you know?
It shows that there's that populate, like what everybody's saying, oh, everybody's instant gratification, but there is obviously more than just a right? sweeping generalization we can make about people.
Totally.
I'm going to go to the cons now.
Well, hold on. Really quickly, I actually just realized I had another point.
Go for it.
And I just lost it. It's gone. So go ahead, Chris. Go ahead. Go to the cons.
Wow, great, Mitch. Thank you for that.
I literally just lost it. You went to cons, and I lost it. So go ahead.
Speaking of the thing about when you guys are talking about these games having quality assurance from the people who matter most, mm-hmm. I think that that's a big con, that you're losing out on surprising or having those people who want the game most enjoying as much as they can, like the final, what your final vision is.
Yeah.
Because a lot of these early access get such drastic changes that completely change the game after updates. It won't look anything month to month. It could change the direction of the game. And for me, that's one of the main reasons I don't enter into early access, isn't because I, beyond not supporting the fact that you could pay somebody for a game that they don't have to finish anymore because you paid them for it now.
Sure.
But I don't like to play it because if I did like the idea of a game, for instance, that Spy Party game, I don't want to play it in an unfinished state to where I will be surprised by something. For Darkest Dungeon, I've been meaning to pick that up recently since it's been released because I knew that that was in early access, but that's a single player type early access. I really want to ask you about it. Did you play Darkest Dungeon in its early access form?
I did. Yeah, I bought it in early access and I played it after it got officially released too.
What do you feel is the biggest difference between the two experiences, like playing?
I think that Darkest Dungeon is probably one of the better examples of early access out there.
Okay.
So it was in a very good state, a very playable state for most of its early access life. Some of the bigger differences were just a mechanic here and there.
I'm going to stop you there. Mm-hmm. I guess we should explain what it is.
Sure.
What Darkest Dungeon.
Yeah, it's like it's kind of got dungeon crawler aspects, but it's also got a lot of this permadeath that's very common in games now, at least roguelike games, whatever you want to call them. You basically you recruit a band of people kind of XCOM style, and if any one of them dies, they're dead forever, and they all have different classes and different abilities, and it's a dungeon diver. It's good, and it's got a very dark, unique art style, sweet aesthetic.
Could you say it's probably the darkest style?
It might be the darkest out there. Yeah.
So I've
also
heard
there are dungeons. I don't know if we covered that.
Oh yeah.
Wow. That was not clear from the title, so I'm glad you let me know.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the biggest differences between now and when I was playing in EA, just mechanics, just layers, just iteration, you know, like the game was already a fucking game, you know, and now it's just got more stuff, and not bloat, but just systems, subsystems, you know, more classes, different items you can find, so on and so forth.
So Chris, I found that it was like interesting that you said that this is a con because I would almost scratch that, flip it, and reverse it, and I could see that as kind of like a pro if you look at it in the right light. So yes, you can't surprise, you can't surprise, like I guess like the viewer like you or the gamer like you that wants to play it in its finality and wants to just like be surprised by all the things that you've got going on. However, if you release this game in whatever state it's in, maybe that was your final vision and you release it and then you don't get a lot of positive feedback from it. Now you get the money that allows you to maybe improve upon your idea. You go, oh shit, okay, this didn't work out as well as I thought it was. It's not as fun as I thought it would be. Users don't like this, users don't like that. I can maybe make some changes to the game and allow it to be a better playable game, which I would not have been able to do if I had just released it.
Yeah, that that's good, but like in that case for Darkest Dungeon, the game was almost complete at that point.
Well, right? Darkest Dungeon's not a good example of that, but like Minecraft is completely different from when it was in early access. It's like not even the same game anymore.
That's a different kind of game. I'm more especially talking about now with this is single players. Mm-hmm. Like a single player, for instance, Divinity Original Sin. Mm-hmm. That was a kind of like a dungeony crawly. It's like more like an RPG type game. But they announced what they did. What I liked is that when they said it was in early access, they restricted the players to, I think, like 70% of the world that was made in early access. Like there was still 30% that they couldn't access in early access because the developers wanted to keep some of it still secret.
Okay.
And so, I haven't heard of that happening in any there. I'm probably there might have been, but that's something that they were actually, you know, they that was one of their worries. That was one of their major concerns. Like they didn't want to ruin the full story or the full game.
Sure.
Through releasing it in early access.
Right, well, something sense. You that mentioned, Chris, was that you know, having just your player base being your QA group essentially as a negative. Mitch kind of just said, you know, he doesn't want Joe California testing his game, but the fact of the matter is, like, the game industry has a well established QA process, and
yeah.
it's not like just some asshole doesn't know what he's doing. Games that are in early access don't necessarily have a legitimate QA process. They just make changes, release it, collect feedback, which is cool. That's good. That's good also. It's just a matter of whether or not it's sufficient completely. You know, you can't leave all of the testing up to the player base. Hopefully not. I don't know if titles do that or not. I certainly hope not. But a part of me thinks that, I mean, with these small indie development groups, that might actually be the case sometimes. They don't actually have any sort of QA process whatsoever. And so that way it is a negative.
Candy. Yeah, I mean, like you said, Chris, that game you were talking about that just has two people, I mean, they are their QA, right? They are their own quality assurance. They're going to play the game, they're going to like it, they're going to try it, and maybe they can't afford it, and that would, you know, hinder these types of games coming out because they can't afford a QA group. So can we think of any other cons before we move on? Like, are there any other, like, negatives to, you know, developing in early access? Like, what do you think some problems that are... that would like arise from developers who try to use this EA style, this early access style?
There's no like way to put these people who are putting the games in early access, I mean, on the spot. Like when they release a game in early access, it could be in any state. There's no standard that is set to how finished the game should be.
Yeah.
Right.
That's
a big one too. I think that's a really good point.
If you include like the biggest offender of this scenario is Steam Greenlight, mm-hmm. which is Steam's version. Like it's a great idea. Steam allows the community to vote to greenlight games that are all they have to do. Steam's greenlight criteria is something simple. It's got to be like you put 4 screenshots of your game. And I think 1 media or 1 video or something of it. And that's it. And then so people see that and they green light it. So then Steam gets to, or they get to promote their game on Steam or either make the full game or even release it in early access from then on. Yeah. A couple years ago, maybe a year ago, it was a game like Earth 2066, Beyond Earth, something.
Right.
It was an awful shithole game.
Right.
Like it. The guy described it as like, I want to make a game that's like a mix of Fallout and Half-Life 2. And everybody's like, what? That's so crazy. How are you going to do that? The guy just used whatever programming thing he was using the assets from that program, like the default gun, like shotgun. Yeah, stock.
Yeah.
And it was just like one tiny little map with a couple hills and a building you could run through the walls in.
Mm-hmm.
And that was released on early access for like $20.
Right.
It wasn't a game. It was like a buggy map.
Yes, that's true. But Chris, that's a very specific example. And that example in particular, Valve removed and offered refunds because
you're absolutely right.
They do have standards. Like I think maybe almost because of that incident, Valve established standards for their early access because because of that instance. They have and actually not even because of the state that the game was in. What they established were the rules that your game can be in any state of development as long as you're transparent about what that state is. And so they alleged, Valve alleged, that Earth 2066 or whatever it was called was not honest about the state that the game was in and collected money. And that's not cool. Okay. That's not cool for the consumer. That's totally, you know, under...
Right. It's skeevy.
It's skeevy, yeah. It's totally skeevy. And Valve put the kibosh on that. So at least we have, if we're talking about Steam's early access group in particular, some sort of standards to rest our laurels on.
Yeah.
Yep.
Go ahead, Dakota.
I was going to say, speaking of Steam early access, it seems like we see a lot of survival games, specifically in EA. Is there a reason for that? Do we think that early access behooves some genres better than it does others?
I mean, it very obviously behooves survival games. Like, that's clear.
Sure. I think it does behoove survival games because of the nature of the survival game, right? It's not a first-person shooter where... it's not a single-player game where, you know, you have a storyline you can keep going. It's a survival game, so it's like an open map already. There's not like you have to hit certain points. And right. then the more that you add into it, it's just right. like these people are finding different yep. part, different new things in the game. It's part of the exploration almost, that every other exactly. patch, hey, look, something's added in. So I think it works itself really well into early access just by the nature of that kind of game.
I thought right. the well, same the layout- exact thing.
The layout is very simple. Like, for all intents and purposes, yes, it's not always going to be like this, but it's essentially a giant square. And then you just start throwing shit in it, and maybe you like yeah. start carving out tunnels,
right?
You know, and you just kind of carve it as you go.
Yeah, and add in vehicles.
We said survival games, but I think more broadly, it's sandbox games. Sandbox games right. just lend yes, themselves definitely. To this. Like, there's no like game over state. There's no winning state. It's just the game loop is all mid game. There's no end game. There's no game over. You just play.
Yeah.
You just the game loop of collect stuff, craft stuff, use stuff just goes on forever. And they just add more stuff for you to play with. And that's probably why I think sandbox games work so damn well with early access.
Definitely right. I think maybe sort of like a fighting game. Or any sort of like combat, like one-on-one combat style game might also lend itself to that, because all you really got to do is create the maps that you're making. You know, for example, like a Smash Brothers game or whatever, like Rivals of Aether. I'm pretty sure I picked it up on early access, and it's just literally like a Smash Brothers clone. And you just create the little flat maps or like the maps with ledges, and you make characters. And when it came out, they only had 6. Now they have 8. I don't even know if it's released yet. I haven't kept up on it because I own it, so who cares? But I think that type of thing also lends itself to early access pretty well, because you just kind of, you can dump it in there with only a few characters and then just slowly trickle in more characters as you go.
Yeah.
Almost, but in a multiplayer game like that, I don't know why you wouldn't just make your game kind of free to play at that point. Because League, Heroes of the Storm, those kinds of MOBA games, they do exactly that. But they're... pretty much, you know, they're released. You know what I mean? Like, they have a pool of heroes. They're patching every month. They're adding new characters.
I think that's because in fighting games specifically, like, each of these characters functions differently, like, from their movements to their moves, whereas League, the only real difference is their moves. Like, they all right-click to move. Right, but they all right-click to move around the map. They all have generally the same speed. Like, that's not the same for fighting games. Some of them can be slower.
I don't know if I agree with that.
I don't agree with that at all.
I think
I'm using Rivals of Aether as an example. They all have completely different speeds and completely different, like, vastly different play styles, to the point where, like, if I don't like any of the 6 that you come out with and I have to, like, farm one of them to buy the other, I'm not going to play your game. I'm just not going to do
that. I think I'll speak for Chris. Murky, for me, that doesn't warrant enough of a difference from, like, a MOBA to explain why they chose a different business model in this case, or in the general case of these games versus League. I think it's just money. I mean, like, a small development studio just might need that capital up front in order to continue making the game. Just a guess. I can't say for sure with Rivals of Aether or any game.
That makes sense. I mean, Riot Studios probably had a large startup capital when they released League of Legends. They didn't really need the money up front. So. Yeah. Yeah, and you're also going to get more people from a free-to-play as well. So that makes sense. Definitely. So, I mean, do we think that this early access trend has affected the game industry, like, as a whole?
Yeah, I definitely think so. I'm going to take Dakota's actually Street Fighter scenario. I think games, AAA games, are being released almost in an early access state right now.
Wow, you were talking about stuff I was going to mention later. Talk to me about this, Chris. We'll have a conversation.
What about how they released like Street Fighter with just online play that wasn't working?
Yes.
Like, yeah. That's unbelievable that you expect people to pay $60 for a game that's not finished with promises that they're going to add it in the future. That's literally early access that they're not naming as early access.
Okay, so I was going to ask you guys, you just kind of came on this on your own. AAA titles, or can AAA titles be involved in the early access space? Should they be? In the instance of Street Fighter, do you think that it would have like avoided the flack it got, avoided the negative reviews, if it had just said, this is an early version, it's an early access, it's a early tournament mode, something, something, something? Because the reason that they did release it early was specifically so that they could get their competitive circuit going, the Capcom Pro Tour. So they had a very specific motivation for releasing it when they did. And it was, as you said, in an incomplete state. So could they have gotten away with saying, we're going to release this game in early access now, it will be done in 2 months?
To be honest, that's kind of a bullshitty reason that about their pro circuit, because right now there's Overwatch pro teams that are practicing and they're in the beta. Like,
right,
you could just give it access to streamers or pro gamers and be like, hey, look, they're starting now, and then let them stream it, and everybody will get really excited, be like, oh my God, look at what he's doing with this guy. I can't wait to play him when the game comes out.
It's not practice. They had events that were in the circuit already.
I mean, that's...
And Chris, that also like kind of touches on what we talked about during the fighting game episode, where like the fighting game community is more of like, anybody can walk up and play it. So if you just give the early access to the pros, that's going to start a fire.
Right. There is no distinction between pro players and players. There are just players. You don't have to be signed. You don't have to be selected or invited. All there. Right.
Well, of course, obviously that, but at least there are no names, I'm sure, in the Street Fighter community. And if they give it to those people, that's just free marketing for them in a certain way. Mm-hmm. And I don't think a AAA developer they have no reason to release an early access game. They're AAA for a reason. They have the money behind them. There's nothing that they need to keep. They don't need us to fund them. They are the funders.
Well, you say there's no reason, but I think there's a very, very obvious reason. I mean, you just said it yourself. They released a game in a state that one might describe or confuse with early access. So if they just called it that, would that be acceptable?
I don't think it would.
Why
because
not?
That's why they didn't either. Call it early access, because they know that they're a big name, a giant company with millions of dollars of revenue. Mm-hmm. Like, why would they? They wouldn't have the gall to be like, "Hey, help us fund this game. Meanwhile, right, let's hold a $1 million tournament." Like, what the hell?
Right. They don't. I agree with you, Chris. This doesn't happen often. But
unprecedented.
Like, AAA like developers, they don't really get the rights to early access. They're not allowed. It's you know, it's like certain other words in our culture. They're not allowed to use that word. All right, that's only for indie developers. Okay,
yeah,
they're not allowed to
like
use that
off limits in a way.
Yeah,
because like if you think about it, their version of early access is almost like a beta, where like that's basically what they get. They're like, hey, give us a bunch of money now, and you can play it, you know, a couple of days or a week or sometimes a month early. That's all they really get. They don't get to call it early access, because honestly, that's like bullshit. And it's exactly what you said, Dakota. Like, they don't need the money. And I mean, I guess the only thing I could think of is like, if they really want like real time quality assurance, just from a gamer standpoint, I don't know. But then again, you could just have
weekend
betas. Yeah, weekend betas. Exactly. That's their cure all for that. So
right,
I say no.
So yeah, right. And it's not that they need it. So maybe what we're saying is, if you don't need QA and you don't need money, those are the only two basically acceptable criteria to call your product early access, because they didn't need either one of those. All they needed was more time. right? They needed another month and a half.
And gamers are used to their games being delayed. Mm-hmm. Like, time is – people will be pissed, but nobody's not really bought a game because it's like, oh, it took too long to come out. I mean
– Well, this is a specific forever. Example, Everybody though, because –
yeah.
Right, they really again, wanted about... Street Fighter V to be on, I think it, what is it, Evo? They wanted Street Fighter V to be played on Evo instead of Street Fighter IV Ultra.
Uh-huh.
I think was like one of the big things that I had heard was that they really wanted to push it so that people had enough time to practice for some of the big tournaments like Evo. So right.
They wanted to get the hands, they wanted to get the game in everyone's hands. And with a game that is like a console exclusive release, you can't just say, we're going to give it to you early and not call it release. They're kind of bound by the system. When they release the game, they have to call it a release. It's being retailed on shelves in boxes. So they don't have the luxury that like online PC, Mac, digital games have where they can release it in incremental iterations. So maybe they're just screwed. They're stuck. I think they bit off more than they could chew development-wise, and so they were unable to meet their schedule, which normally, as you said, Chris, wouldn't matter. People are used to games being delayed. But in this case, it mattered in a very specific way. They had a Pro Tour to start.
Right.
And again, that specific way, I don't think is one that they can justify, because that's also a way to just promote their game in another way. Like,
no,
it's not for the good of...
Not.
I don't...
I think they had the best intentions.
That's quite cynical for a game in a game establishment, the fighting game community that has been around for 25 years. I mean, that
it doesn't matter how long they've been around. I mean, the Mafia's been around for like 30.
Well, matters insofar as this is not just a way to promote their game. This is something that they've been doing for years and years and years.
It is a way to promote their game. If the newest game isn't at the biggest tournament of that year when it has the potential to be like, oh, we're just going to have Evo. Oh, we're going to have Evo plus Street Fighter V. Wah! Everybody's going to show
it's,
up.
No, do you think not, that there's it's, a... It's not like that.
I don't think that people are going to not... Okay, if a game is not at
people
Evo...
People definitely would still go.
Do you think that people are not going to buy the game? The people that would have bought the game for Evo anyway? Who?
People are obviously going to buy the game, but there is...
So how is it promotion?
You cannot deny that there would be more excitement if a new, brand new game is at an Evo than opposed to the regular old, set.
So people I said this before,
more
but
excited
this,
for the newest thing.
I said this before. This is not exclusively about Evo. Mitch brought that up, and I think that's probably... 10% of the reason. It's not about Evo. It's not about one event. It's about an ongoing series of events that they plan on having for the life of the game.
Yeah.
It's not promotion. It is what the game is going to be in the hands of professional players.
Yeah, Chris, I think this all comes down to a little bit of a misunderstanding of the fighting game community. You and I don't really have a large understanding, but like it's almost like Smash Brothers. If there's a bunch of Smash Brothers tournaments coming out, like people are going to buy the game that the tournaments are at. So even if it takes 2 months for the game to come out, in 2 months, everybody is going to buy that game. Like literally everyone's going to buy it. Everybody that would have bought it 2 months ago is going to buy it now. So it's not a matter of promotion. They're going to get the same amount of people no matter what. It's just a matter of timing, and they really wanted it to sync up with the pro circuit. And I don't think that's wrong, because they're trying to do it for the players. They know the players want to play this game on the pro circuit and not, the old game on the pro circuit.
I think it's naive to think that they don't know that people are going to be excited about a game close to a time when that would be the most important time for that game. Fighter games are all about the pro circuit, all about the tournaments. So if you don't have this game out in time to meet all these tournaments, it's you're not going to get as big of a buzz about
you're
it.
You're still misunderstanding, at least by the language you're using. It's not to make it to tournaments that they'd otherwise miss. It is an event that is exclusively for this game. It's not like they would have done the Capcom Pro Tour with Street Fighter 4 if 5 didn't make a deadline. That's not what would have happened. There would have been no events whatsoever.
Community would have been very upset about it.
It's an interesting thing. They basically set themselves artificial deadlines that were more important than the typical release schedule deadline. But how else has early access affected the gaming industry at large, do you guys think? So I'll tell you something that came to my mind. The way that video game sites review games has changed because early access games are not reviewable. right? A game review is intended to evaluate the final state of a game development cycle. And early access games are not there yet. And so if you can't review a static final state, what can you review? Something is always changing, you know? And so what a lot of websites have done is they'll do like a like an early look or a preview or something with the tacit agreement that it's not final and it might change, but here's what's going on now. What do you guys think about that?
I mean, it's a weird way to review things. It's kind of a weird setup that we have now with this early review. Yeah, it's basically like, well, at first, like, because you could have a game, like, realistically that, oh, at first this game was like, and this goes back to our game review episode, but at first you could have a game that's like a 9 or whatever, or like an 8.5, I guess, say, if we're being realistic.
Very good.
And then like maybe after it comes out, people find out more about it. They find out the end game, like Firewatch, they find out the end game is not as good as they wanted it to be. Now it's a 6. Mm-hmm. Like that's, I mean, those are, I know that those don't seem like a lot because it's only 2.5 points, but that's like a big difference in game right there.
Sure.
It's, to me, it's similar in the way that they rate MMOs. Right?
Yes, like you can, definitely.
Like, reviewers wouldn't be able to review an MMO for at least, like, a month after it's come out when the servers actually populate and people are actually getting to the end game content and can work together on it. Mm-hmm. So, right. Yeah, it's definitely... I agree with a lot of the review sites that only review a game once it's actually out.
Yeah, yes. Do you think the answer is we shouldn't review early access games? We just should not have a review. Like wait till it actually is released.
I don't think so.
We definitely should not. No.
I mean, yeah, you shouldn't review. No, there's no sense in reviewing. You can preview. You can talk about. You can have conversations. You can track development. Right. You can't review a game that is not done.
Or if you're going to review it without like a score. Just review it and say, here's my thoughts. But like, don't give it like an actual set score.
There is something to say, though, that it might be important to try to have a review of it in some way as people are spending money on it.
And I think that's why most gaming sites feel that they're almost obligated in a way to definitely have coverage, because it's a product that people can buy. So people need to be talking about it.
Yeah.
I agree.
That's difficult. Slippery slope there.
Yeah, definitely. And it kind of begs the question, Steam Early Access, they have reviews, right? And people will post reviews and basically rate the game thumbs up or thumbs down. And so I guess the idea is holistically over thousands of people doing this, you get kind of just a generic or general sense of whether it's good or bad, you know, worth your time and worth your money. The problem, I think, it's a funny case. The Culling last week, the Culling came out with a patch, and the patch was very not well reviewed. It was not well received by the players. They kind of railed against it in a very loud ways, which is fine. That's acceptable, right? But I saw a thread on Reddit, and Reddit is basically the de facto beta forums because they don't have forums of their own, that said, they after receiving a lot of feedback on the patch, they made changes to address the concerns. And so somebody said, okay, now everybody that went in and gave the game a poor Steam review, go back and change it. And I was like, wait a minute. People are giving the game a bad Steam review because of one patch? I think that's fucking atrocious, personally.
I don't think that's correct at all.
I don't either. I think it's irresponsible in a way. What do you think, Chris?
I definitely don't agree with it, but as a developer, that is something to be expected. If you do something shitty, it's something to be expected because that's what people do. Whether you agree with it or not, that's the way the world works. Mm-hmm. I don't care what kind of moral code you have. It's like, Mitch is over there writhing in his chair. I don't agree with it. I would never give a game a bad review because of one bad patch, but people do. And people metabomb. On Metacritic, they metabomb games all the time. They give it a 0. Shit, since this whatever updated. It tells a story about the game's cycle, right? Those people who want to take the time to drop a score because of that will raise it back up later. And it will give an indication of maybe where the how how the development cycle is going, right? If they agree with what they've been paid for in early access so that they could change it in a certain way. Exactly. So I think it's an important part of the cycle.
Are words that I glommed onto. I think that if you're going to write a review of an early access game on Steam, your review should reflect how the development is going, not how it is in one moment in time. I think that in this case, let me give you some background to see if this changes your opinion. The patch, the bad quote-unquote patch, was in effect for 2 days. It took the development team 2 days to iterate, take in the feedback, and make changes that made people happy. And yet still people are going and giving the game a bad review based on a snapshot in time, 2 days. In my opinion, those reviews should reflect how that developer treats their early access game over a large span of time. Not fucking 2 days for sure. And not one patch too, because one patch doesn't give you any context, I don't think. You know, if you see that a developer patch after patch after patch has certain issues with time or quality or whatever, then you can make some, you know, you can make a meaningful statement about that game as an early access product. And so I think that doing anything, speaking to any one snapshot in time, is just not really getting the point of early access. I think there's a tacit agreement when you buy an early access game that, as we've said, you're testing a game. You are engaged in a relationship with the developer in order to make a good product. And it's not about any one moment. It's about the experience. It's about the journey.
Right, but I think
are you proposing to us right now?
Jesus, why don't I just marry early access?
Oh, wait, are you marrying early access or you're marrying us? Like, because I thought you were proposing to us.
Marrying somebody. Yeah. What do you think, Mitch?
It's really awkward.
I don't know. I personally think, like, cause I thought the question was if whether or not someone giving a review based on a 2-day patch is bullshit or not. I think it's complete bullshit. Yes, it happens, but it's still bullshit. Like, yeah. I don't think that I get that it tells a story. I get that it says, like, oh, here's where we were, here's where we are, here's how we got there. Like, I get it. But like you said, when you enter, I think, and that's the problem, is people are buying this early access game and they're going, oh, I get to play this game early. I'm fucking excited. They don't realize that they're playing an unfinished game. I don't think
some
they fully
just buy it and
comprehend
think buying
it.
A game, right?
Yeah, they play a game of the Culling and they're like, oh, this shit is dumb. I'm gonna fucking flame on them. And it's almost speaking back to what we were talking about earlier, that sense of instantaneous gratification. Oh, this game fucking sucks. I lost this game. I'm really pissed about it. I'm gonna go fucking flame them on Steam. Like, that's bullshit.
Seems
your review doesn't matter to me.
Seems
juvenile. Your review does not matter to me. I don't care what you had to say.
You might not, but that has an influence on the large scale.
But that's my point is that shouldn't. That means absolutely
well,
nothing.
It does. Dakota,
as you said, it's a 2-day patch. It shouldn't really affect anything. Yes, you can speak to that patch, and that's fine. But I don't think it should speak to the overall. Like, I think what they should be able to do, I guess, is specifically speaking to Steam, if a game is in a current, like, state, I guess, like we'll go for example, like, this is patch 1.31 or whatever, right? So now the game is The Culling 1.31. So you can write a review on The Culling 1.31, but once you get to 1.32 or once it's fully released, like, that review shouldn't matter because it's not even part of the game anymore. They've either fixed it or what have you. So
it's a tough problem to solve for sure.
People aren't going to go keep going back and reviewing at different points. Like, and then if all they have to do is release a patch where they fix a tree's placement or something, and then all the negative reviews that they had for their game are instantly wiped out.
I understand that there's negative sides to the coin. There's no way to fix it. There's no perfect fix. I just think that it's kind of shitty because a game like The Culling, they fix it in 2 days. That's pretty damn impressive.
Yeah, those guys are pretty on point.
Yes. So, you know, we've talked about early access. We've talked about all these different games that have come out in early access, how we feel about it, our philosophies behind it. Let's move on to the Metabet, because I would like some early access to the Metabet, please. All right, go ahead, Dakota.
All right, for those that don't know, the Metabet is the game where we bet on the Metacritic score of an upcoming video game. Last week we actually messed up the Metabet, and whenever we mess it up, by we I mean I, we all participate in the video game punishment. So we played some Rocket League, and we were only allowed. I'm sorry.
Deal with the fucking communism. We all got to deal with your mistakes.
Yeah,
this is bullshit.
We did. Yeah, this bullshit. Is not a democracy, boys. We played some Rocket League, and we were challenged with only scoring goals upside down, hood down,
upside down,
wheels up.
Hood down, wheels up.
I had fun.
It was a lot of fun.
You guys?
Yeah, like anytime we do a three-man Rocket League challenge, it seems to always be the most fun I've had playing Rocket League.
It is.
I mean, definitely. I liked it. I wasn't good at this particular challenge. Like, I tried. I tried my best.
Yeah.
But at certain points, I was just like, you know what? I'm playing the blocking game. And I started pushing people around and blowing up people. And I had a great time with that.
Chris was our certified goalie. But you did do some upside-down blocks. I will say I noticed them.
I did some upside-down stuff, man. But I think I scored a goal or two, but it was too much work.
We won most of our matches, didn't we?
That was really insane.
I'm pretty sure, I think we played a total of like 10 games, and I'm pretty sure we went like 8-2.
Something like that.
Yeah, we did really well.
We weren't playing ranked, but that's okay.
We were not playing ranked because, come on. That's just ridiculous.
I don't think we would have won a single game if we played ranked, to be honest.
Hey, you know what? We can't prove it.
We don't know. It's right.
Yeah, that's true.
For those of you listening now, which there's like, what, 5 of you? But for those of you listening now, this video will be posted on Thursday when we actually post the episode. So it'll be like in the show notes and stuff like that. So if you're listening at home and you have no idea what the fuck we're talking about, go down, scroll down to the show notes. It's right there. It's a YouTube link.
If you're on the BitCultures website.
No, it'll be there no matter what. It'll be there. You'll find it.
It did occur to me. We always say that the vids are in the show notes. I think the easiest way to find them will be to go to YouTube, look up BitCultures, the channel, and our Analog Stick Radio, playlist.
Playlist.
That's the word. Yeah. We'll have all of our episodes, and it also has our extra video content. So always go there.
You can also just YouTube search. I did this today, actually. You can just YouTube search Metabet Challenge, and all of our Metabet Challenge videos will be right there.
Ooh, very nice. I like that.
So,
all right. So last week, our bets were for the game Quantum Break for the Xbox One. It's one of the bigger console exclusive titles for Xbox. To recap, we're going to list our scores, peakest to weakest. Chris was up top with a score of 90. Mitch estimated 81, and I estimated 79. Today, on the day of release, based on 80 reviews, Quantum Break has a Metacritic score of 78, making me the winner. You guys, the losers.
Fucking Animorphs guy. Fuck you, Animorphs guy.
Fucking Animorphs guy. And Littlefinger. It's all Littlefinger's fault. Per use, right?
It's always Littlefinger's fault.
So, what do you guys want to do? What are you playing together?
God damn it.
Okay, let me get over. Let me shake off the
loser. Shake
losers.
It off, guys. Just Taylor Swift this loser feeling you've got.
God damn. All right, Christopher, what should we play? We just played WoW. I hated it. By the way, I leveled my character up to 20. That was fucking miserable. That was the worst.
I forgot to ask you, right?
That was the worst experience.
Yeah, you did it by yourself.
That was fucking terrible.
Yeah.
Ugh. Anyways, I had to say that.
So not WoW.
I completely forgot. So not WoW. Chris, what's a game we haven't played? Can we do a Hearthstone man fight? We haven't done a Hearthstone thing in a long time.
We did it recently. How about we get a game together?
When did we do it recently?
I don't know.
You get a game together, Chris? What did you have in mind?
I don't know, man. We could get oh my god, how about we get an early access game?
All right, I like this. You know what? I saw this dorky looking first person cowboy shooter. I showed it to Mitch. Remember that link I sent you? I think it's free too. And if it's free, it's even better.
Free is better. Free is better.
Right.
What was it called?
I can't remember. We will find it. It's some shit. First person shooter cowboy looking game. And I say shit in a loving way. If you are the developer of said game, God bless. Thanks for making cowboy games. We need more of them.
Yo, man, the developer of that game is listening to this podcast right now. Like,
he's
100%.
He's our seventh listener. Exactly. All right. Yeah. So you guys are going to need to get this game. It's a PvP game, I do believe. And I need you guys to have a couple man fights, cowboy style.
Hold on. Like, can we just look through the early access?
There's an Orcs Must Die free-to-play game right now, an open beta.
Okay.
Have you ever played, you know what Orcs Must Die is? It was a tower defense, Mitch. You love Chris, tower defense.
I remember this game. You owned Orcs Must Die.
Yeah, I played both of them.
Chris, can you just go to Steam and can you look up Crazy Cars 3D? Because I need you to see this game. This game is $3 and it looks ridiculous.
Okay. Oh Jesus. this game looks like shit. There's a bunch of polygons. Now there's
I'm sure
a
this is like a super awesome thrill to listen to in the podcast format. But moving on, we need to pick a game and pick something for you guys to do. So it's gonna be cowboy time. Definitely gonna be cowboy time. So I'm gonna need you guys to cowboy up and play some of this cowboy game. We'll know what it's called when we find it. In the meantime, we need to be betting on a new game for this week.
Okay.
The game that we are betting on for this week is none other than Ratchet and Clank for PlayStation 4.
This is a
reboot. This is actually the first game remade on the PS4. Remade. We had our episode. This is remade from scratch with all the new tech, you know, different bosses, different levels. It's kind of just telling the story of the first game, but it's a new game as far as gameplay is concerned. So, Ratchet and Clank for the PS4. I've got my bid written down in chat.
This is a tough one.
Yeah, that's a beloved series, man.
Yeah, and it looked really fucking good. Like, really, really good.
Mm-hmm.
Shit. Okay.
I got my number.
Shit. Chris, what was your number?
It was screw you. Number
damn it.
Four.
Okay. I have my number now. I got it. Okay.
Old man Mitch taking his time over there.
Chris, you've got yours.
Hey, have my number.
Yeah, I got my number.
Hit him in chat on the count of three. 1, 2, 3. All right, it's going to be a close one. So from peakest to weakest, we've got Chris up top. He's bid 88. I am right below him with 87. Mitch going with the tried and true 82. We'll see, guys. We will see.
Well, as always, Analog Stick Radio is brought to you by BitCultures. Now, BitCultures is a site that features video game reviews, opinion pieces, and digital media just like this podcast right here. You're listening to it. So if this is something that you like, if this is something that you're interested in, go to www.bitcultures.com. Check everything out. There's a lot of really cool stuff there. If you want to reach us Analog Stick Rad guys, you can email us analogstickradio@gmail.com, or you can tweet us. We love tweets at ASR Podcast. Now, I know these are very difficult. Write them down. If you're in the car, I don't care. Write it down. Analog Stick Radio records every Tuesday night right here, twitch.tv/analogstickradio, 8 p.m. Pacific, 11 p.m. Eastern. And then the following Thursday, so in a couple days, you'll hear this one on all of your favorite podcast trackers that Thursday. Guys, any parting words before we go figure out what the fuck this cowboy game is called?
None for me.
No, nothing.
Yeah, nothing.
None whatsoever? No sharpshooting, Chris?
No. Oh, sharpshooting.
Yeah.
You got to call it the Brokeback Boys.
Oh, God. Well, once again, my name is Mitch. For myself, Chris, Dakota, this has been Analog Stick Radio. We'll see you next week.
See ya.
Bye-bye.